We'll now move on to the last module of our pilot seminar, and that's checklists. As you'll see from the picture in front of you, this was from October 30, 1935, in which a flying fortress crashed, killing both pilots. A number of other people on board the aircraft survived, however, had injuries. Now, you'll see from the news article statement on the side of the screen there, it says, "Too much plane for one man to fly." But what actually came out of the investigation from this incident was not so much that it was too much plane for one man to fly, but one, that the control locks had failed to be removed from the aircraft before takeoff. And number two, there was further consideration of how complex aircraft were starting to become, even for two very experienced test pilots, and that something needed to be done. And that was the introduction of checklists. Now, this happened back in 1935, and you would think that we've moved a long way since then. But I'm now going to fast forward 83 years to December 2018. On this particular occasion, the pilot failed to remove the control locks from their aircraft and didn't complete their pre-takeoff checks, so moving freely. The pilot was actually not in the habit of using control locks in this particular circumstance. And the aircraft had just been serviced and the engineer had taxied the aircraft back to where it was actually being refueled and installed the control lock in the aircraft. Now, you may think back to something else that we've talked about already during this seminar, where someone had decided to put something on an aircraft but didn't actually advise the pilots or those involved with the aircraft. Remember the Malaysian Airlines aircraft in Brisbane with the pitot tube covers? We've got a similar circumstance with lack of communication. The pilot was delayed and the fuel bowser had become unserviceable. And when the pilot eventually taxied for departure, the pilot was actually concentrating on their flight plan on their iPad at the particular time. So now we're hitting on points that we've already seen in some other scenarios throughout our seminar as part of our pre-flight planning. The pilot in this circumstance then attempted to take off with the control lock in place, and this was the outcome. Now let's look at this in regard to James Reason's Swiss cheese model. As part of James Reason's Swiss cheese model, Reason defines organisational accidents as situations in which latent conditions arising mainly from management decisions, workplace practices, cultural influences, combine adversely with local triggers or events. So things like weather, location, workplace conditions, equipment failures, and in addition to that, with active failures. So maybe the actions of the individuals, errors, procedure violations committed by the individual teams at the sharp end of the organisation to produce the accident. Now, if we have a look at this particular accident in relation to James Reason model, we look at those latent conditions that occurred on the particular day. The pilot did not use the control lock, and the control lock can actually be inserted upside down on some aircraft. And we'll look at an example of this very shortly. Some of the local conditions that combined with this was that the fuel bowser was US, so maybe there was a stress then placed on the pilot. There was a short taxi distance between the fuel bowser and the actual runway. It was a good weather day. And as you know, sometimes in good weather, we become complacent. Some of the actions of the actual individual that contributed to this were the engineer installed the control lock, not the pilot. And the pilot was using the electronic flight bag whilst taxiing. All of these then led to the holes in the Swiss cheese lining up, leading to the accident. So if we look at the barriers then that can be put in place, one of those is checklists, ensuring that the control lock is actually not in place. Control checks, and then planning prior to the actual taxi process. And these could have all been barriers to prevent the accident from occurring. Now I said that the control lock can potentially be inserted upside down. Take this picture of a Cessna. If you have a look at the picture on the left side of the screen, can you actually see the control lock? You can see a very small portion in between the actual control column there. Now, what about the control lock here on the right side of the screen? It's a lot easier to identify. And what it actually does is prevent us from accessing those key areas of the aircraft so that we actually can't start the aircraft. So why are we actually discussing checklists? We've already determined that they assist in creating a barrier to accidents from occurring. If we look at a recent Australian Transport Safety Bureau case of the King Air that departed from Essendon, in this particular situation, the rudder trim was not set to its correct location. This photo shows the rudder trim of the Beech 200 King Air. For takeoff, the trim setting should be neutral. Use of the rudder trim is required during single engine operations, and the Beech 200 at Essendon was found to have the rudder trim in full nose left position. During takeoff, the rudder would have become more effective, increasing the effect and thus requiring greater input from the pilot. After becoming airborne, the aircraft was observed to be in a substantial sideslip prior to collision with the DFO buildings at Essendon. The investigation could not determine when the rudder trim was set to full nose left. However, it is seen that on the checklist it appears numerous times prior to takeoff, and therefore a significant part of the checklist. I now have a video for you to watch. This video comes from the CASA Human Factors Kit. Have a look and see what may seem obvious to you.
How many different components can you identify on the workbench during this conversation between a pilot and engineer?
Some parts just wear out.
How long do they normally last?
A long time with the correct maintenance, but some bits get replaced when they reach their service life.
It's about wear and care.
Time, data, and good maintenance.
What are some things I can do?
Be thorough with your inspections.
Always am, but you could show me how to be better.
Fill out the maintenance releases with enough detail to help with troubleshooting. And make sure they're legible and not a chicken scroll. You guys write like doctors.
Okay, all right, I got it. Write clearly, good dailies and detail.
It's my livelihood, but it's your life.
If you counted 10 different components on the bench in the foreground, well done. But watch again for all the other changes.
Some parts just wear out.
How long do they normally last?
A long time with the correct maintenance, but some bits get replaced when they reach the end of their service life.
It's about wear and care.
Time, data, and good maintenance.
What are some things I can do?
Be thorough with your inspections.
Always am, but you could show me how to be better.
Fill out the maintenance releases with enough detail to help with troubleshooting. And make sure they're legible and not a chicken scroll. You guys write like doctors.
Okay, all right, I got it. Write clearly, good dailies and detail.
It's my livelihood, but it's your life.
As you can see from that video, you don't always know what you're looking for, and that's where checklists can come in handy. We've already talked about why planning isn't necessarily completed, or maybe why we're ineffective in our decision making. Let's have a talk about why maybe we don't necessarily complete checklists. The first one is attitude. Maybe there's an actual lack of motivation to use the checklist. Distractions or interruptions. And this occurs either while we're doing our checklist or maybe conducting routine activities, such as our pre-flight check of our aircraft. And as you'll see by the screen, the walk around is a common time that we do get distracted. And what should we do? Start from the beginning. Because we don't necessarily know where we stopped. Expectations and perceptions. So maybe there's a thought out there that my passengers will ask, why am I actually using a checklist? Shouldn't I know what I'm doing? Or the perception that, hey, I'm a fairly experienced pilot. I know all the things that I need to follow. But have we maybe forgotten something? Time pressures. Do I have enough time to actually do this? No, I need to get in the aircraft and go. And we've already talked about the get-there-itis. So let's now talk about when you would expect to rely on maybe those memory or routine items rather than using a physical checklist. And those times may be when we're in an emergency situation and we're carrying out critical initial actions or those memory items, nose down, change tanks. Or maybe it's just in those normal circumstances of we need to go around. there's not enough time to actually pull out a checklist, so therefore we're powering up down the runway and carrying out our normal routine. Or maybe it's physically impossible. And a perfect example of that is our helicopter pilots, where both hands are actually in use in order to fly the aircraft. So checklists, they're a great idea. They're a final defense and they come in many forms, as we've just seen. They're not necessarily just the physical piece of paper, but maybe they are looking left to right in our cockpit, working through those particular memory items that we've just discussed.